Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship today. Have you all dried out? I prayed all the way down from Mayville this morning that the Lord would take this stuff out of here. The farmers cannot get on their fields. It's just been, you can't paint outside, you can't mow the grass. How many of you have got grass up to your knees in your yard? Yeah. Oh, so we just need to pray that the Lord takes it away and he brings us some sunshine. But your nice sunny faces in here. Right, look at that sunny face over there, Pastor Snow. Yeah, there we go. All right. So we are glad that you're all here today to worship. Please take time to fill out the attendance card in the pew. If you are a visitor, there's one side for that. If you're a member, please fill out that side, and they'll pick that up as we sing our sermon hymn today. So we encourage you to get that done ahead of time. So let's stand as we praise the Lord today with first three verses of 941. We begin our worship as we do all of life, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Thanks be to God, brothers and sisters, by the power of His Spirit, our faith is growing more and more, and our love for one another is increasing as we follow our Savior, Jesus Christ.
We have been by grace.
to his family.
We join now in confessing our sins based on Ephesians chapter 3. Let us come to God's throne of grace to confess our sins, kneeling before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. Almighty Creator, though you are the Father of all who live, I have disobeyed your word. I have been unfaithful to you, to your children in my human family, and to my brothers and sisters in Christ. I have not loved you above all things, and loved my neighbor as myself. I have done wrong. I am sorry. Forgive me for Jesus' sake. Renew my will to live for you. Amen. Praise the Lord, children of God. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. He does not treat you as your sins deserve. As high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far he has removed our transgressions from us. Your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Spirit of power and life, unify our families and our family of faith as we focus Jesus, our Lord and Savior. As we rest in his saving grace, lead us to follow the path of his gracious life. As we fix our eyes on him, fill our lives with the Father's incredible and abundant blessings. Amen.
Splendid glory, enthroned at God's right hand, upholding earth and heaven, by forces you command. We know that you will come as our judge that final day, so
be seated. The scripture lessons for today, again, focus our faith on our family as we're focusing on our family this fall. And so the first lesson is from Psalm 25, and you'll notice it's responsively. I'll read first part, and then you respond with the second. Show me your ways, Lord. Teach me your paths. Remember, Lord, your great mercy and love, for they are from of old. Do not remember the sins of my youth and my rebellious ways.
According to your love, remember me, for you, Lord, are good.
Good and upright is the Lord. Therefore, he instructs sinners in his ways. All the ways of the Lord are loving and faithful towards those who keep the demands of his covenant.
For the sake of your name, Lord, forgive my iniquity, though it is great.
Who then are those who fear the Lord? He will instruct them in the ways they should choose. The Lord confides in those who fear him. He makes his covenant known to them.
My eyes are ever on the Lord, for only he will release my feet from the snare.
This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our New Testament letter is taken from the book of Hebrews, the 12th chapter. We make our faith journey with our eyes fixed on Jesus. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. This is the word of the Lord. Let us rise for the gospel preparation.
Father of all our God of peace, we look to you alone. Come with your precious gift of love and make our house your home.
The good news of Jesus is found in John chapter 6, beginning in verse 61. We focus on Jesus, whose words give spirit and life. Aware that his disciples were grumbling about this, Jesus said to them, "Does this offend you? Then what if you see the Son of Man ascended to where he was before? The Spirit gives life, the flesh counts for nothing. The words I have spoken to you, they are full of spirit and life. Yet there are some of you who do not believe." For Jesus had known from the beginning which of them did not believe and who would betray him. He went on to say, "This is why I told you that no one can come to me unless the Father has enabled them." From this time, many of his disciples turned back and no longer followed him. "You do not want to leave me too, do you?" Jesus asked the 12. Simon Peter answered, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and to know that you are the Holy One of God." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Jesus Christ.
You may be seated.
Invite the children to come forward at this time for the children's lesson. And as they're coming up, just a few announcements for our family of faith. First of all, this is LWML Sunday, and we honor that in a number of different ways. You see the display in the entryway area about mites, and they'd love to help have you throw your spare chain into a mite box and help them in terms of supporting some of the mission that they do. Lutheran Women's Missionary League has been around for a long, long time, and our Women in Ministry group is affiliated with them and continues to support the missions that they support. Our sixth grade brunch is next Sunday for sixth grade members in the sixth grade on living as teens and parenting teenagers. Milwaukee Area Life Chain is going to be Sunday from 2 to 3:30. You can find details about that in your bulletin. And the blood drive is set now for November 1st. So watch over the next few weeks for opportunities to sign up for the blood drive. We've always been very, very supportive here at Immanuel and been able to collect a lot of blood for those in need. So really appreciate your attention to that as those things come up. Good morning. It is a good morning in spite of the rain, but they say that's going to go away a little bit. I brought a couple of things along with me today to help us think about a word like focus. This is a, what do you use it for? See things that are small, that's right. So if you can't see real well, and I actually got this for Menards as my birthday gift. I think they know how old people are. when they send you a birthday gift card, because maybe they thought I would need a magnifying glass. Because a lot of people, as they get older, their eyes don't work so well, and they have to wear some glasses that are like magnifying glasses in them so that they can read things that are close up. They're often referred to as readers. Now, I don't need those, but I know a lot of people who do. I can't see far away, so I need glasses to see farther away. But what does a magnifying glass do? It helps you focus on things that are close. And yet, if I move it away, like if I hold my hand like this, is it in focus? Huh? If I hold it like this, it kind of gets all fuzzy when it's not at the right distance. If I hold it close, then you're able to see a whole lot better because the lens helps focus. But you got to have the thing that you're looking at just the right distance. And not only do we focus with this kind of magnifying glass on things up close, but then we have these for when we have to see something that's far away. That's right. But on these, how do you focus? Does anybody know how you focus a pair of binoculars? What do you have to do? Well, you put both eyes up there, but there's still something. It can be kind of fuzzy out there. And so if I show you, if you watch real carefully, you see this turns. And that helps focus this one. And then on top, there's another button that turns up here. And that helps focus on the other one. So I can put it up to my eyes, but if something's out of focus, I'll turn this a little bit until things are sharp. Right now, Mr. Halstead's looking really good to me. Okay? And I can move this one so that things are in focus. So I want you to think about that. We focus with binoculars. We focus with a magnifying glass. But we also focus with faith. And in the Bible it says, who's supposed to be in our focus is Jesus. That's right, Jesus. And so so today he wants to remind us that as we're making our way through life, we should always keep Jesus as our focus. And how do we do that? Well, we do that by when we come together and worship, but that's only once a week. He wants us to do it every day. And we do it by reading his word, by praying every day. It helps us keep our focus on Jesus. And why do we want to focus on Jesus? Because when we watch him, we can learn not only that our sins are forgiven because he died for us, but also how to love and forgive other people as we keep our focus on him. So let's ask him to help us do that today in our prayer. Would you pray with me? I invite the congregation to pray along. Heavenly Father, thank you for giving us Jesus. Help us to remember and to focus on him so that we can know we are your children with sins forgiven, and so that we can know how to love and serve just like Jesus did. Amen. So to remind you today, I've got a picture of binoculars, magnifying glass, and Jesus as your focus. So come on up and get one and get a set of markers too.
Thank you.
Grace, mercy, and peace are yours from God our Father and from our dear Lord and our Savior Jesus. Amen. Our text today is the portion of the letter to the Hebrews that we had read about fixing our eyes on Jesus. Mitch, can I have you turn on the monitor up there, because this one, the one that faces me, isn't on. Oh, that's not good. I'm flying blind today, I guess, okay? So I'll be doing a lot of looking over my... So let's think a little bit about focus. Think about some of the ways that we are called to focus. When you're learning to play baseball and you're up to bat, one of the things the coaches will say is keep your eye on the ball, right? Because you can't hit what you're not looking at. And of course, as you get up in more advanced kinds of leagues, you got a ball coming at you a lot quicker, so you better be able to duck if the pitch is a little errant. You better keep your eye on the ball. Sometimes, and this comes out of the scriptures, it'll say keep your eye on the prize. Keep your eye on the prize. And that comes from the time in which the New Testament was written, at the games that were held. Very often the trophy, the prize that would be won, was there on public display. I guess I'd liken it in our day and age to the time when the Wisconsin football team plays the Minnesota football team. And what are they playing for? They're playing for the axe, right? There's this great big Paul Bunyan axe that is brought out at the beginning of the game, and the team that wins gets to go get it and parade around the field, right? We won. Here's the prize. Keep your eye on the prize. Sometimes we have somebody say, I got my eyes on you, right? And sometimes that can be kind of ominous. I'm watching you, so be careful, you know, that kind of thing. Or it can be, like so often happens in our culture, you got parents and family and friends who come to watch you at a game, to cheer you on. And they got their eyes on you. And very often they'll miss other things that are going on in the game because they're watching you, what you're doing, how you're performing, while maybe some other action is going on out here, and they don't see it because they got their eyes on you. The question today is, where's your focus? Where's my focus as we make our journey home to our Lord and Savior? And how best do we also run the race that God has given us in this world, to run the race, as the Bible says, set before us? Where's our focus? Well, as a family, it's important to have focus, whether it's in our individual families or whether it's in our family of faith. And so today we want to focus on this aspect of God's Word, that He calls us to be a focused family. In our families, to let Jesus be the center of our homes. And in our family of faith, to let Jesus be the one who guides, directs, and moves us forward as people of God. And I would suggest, on the basis of this text, we can say a couple of things about being a focused family. First of all, that we're careful not to get distracted. And secondly, that we're determined to move in the direction that God is calling us. Now let's get this lesson in front of us, and especially see this not distracted and but determined kind of thing laid out for us. So would you read the text with me again? Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. So the first thing he says is, don't get distracted, especially by the things that entangle us, things that come from sin. And let's stay focused and determined on running the race that God has set before us. One of the challenges with running that race in this world is that we're called to run by faith. And we see that by the witnesses that he surrounded us with. And we see it also in the life of our Jesus, who ran his race with perseverance, not distracted but determined. And that's what the writer to the Hebrews lists up for us in the second half of our text. Let's read that part together. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. Jesus was focused as he entered this world as our Savior, with the mission that he had to do as the Messiah, the Christ, the Anointed One, anointed to walk a path, a race set before him, not distracted by the things that often would pop up in his life, but determined to make his way to the cross and empty tomb so that you and I might know that he is the Lord of life and you and I might follow him by faith. But we don't do it alone. We do it as a part of a family. And that's the context in which we find this lesson encouched. And that context is described in chapter 11, just before our text. Because, you know, our text begins with the word, therefore. Right? Therefore means there's a whole bunch of stuff that came before that you better pay attention to. And that whole bunch of stuff that came before was what's often referred to as the Heroes of Faith chapter in the Bible. And what you'll find is that in this chapter, there's just a litany, a list of different people from the Old Testament who lived by faith. There is, for instance, Abraham, and a lot of it is about Abraham and how God told them to pack up and move to another land. And there were no travel brochures. There was no travel channel to check it out before you got there. And he just had to, by faith, trust that God was going to lead him in a place that was going to be good for him. And so he packed up and left. And there's another by faith story, which is really instructive for us when we read that Old Testament story of Isaac and being led up the mountain by his father, and then father raised his knife to him. And sometimes people say, well, how in the world could Abraham do it? One of the reasons why we know how Abraham could do it, because Hebrews chapter 11 tells us. And it tells us, here's what Abraham thought. God made a promise. He said, this son Isaac, he's going to be the heir through whom all my children are going to come. That's his promise. God's got to keep his word. Even if I take his life, God's got to raise him from the dead. That was the faith that Abraham had as he raised his hand toward his son. He said, God doesn't lie. And he'll raise this boy from the dead. And we wouldn't know that except for the book of Hebrews. It also lifts up people like Noah, right? Was it raining when Noah started building the ark? Nope. Not like we've had the last few days, right? Now, I'm sure he had rains on and off because it took a little while to build that ark, but he built the ark based on the instruction and promise of God. That was the race set before him, and he ran it by faith. And again in that chapter, we've got people like Abraham and Noah and then Moses, right? He's getting close to 100 years old, and he's taking care of some sheep for his father-in-law, and he's up on Mount Horeb, which is also Mount Sinai, also known as Mount Sinai, and there's a bush that's on fire, but it's not burning up, and God talks to him and says, Moses, you got a job for me to do. You got to go get my people out of Israel. They're slaves there, And Moses had all kinds of reasons not to do that. After all, he left that country because he had to, because of what he had done. And he knew these people were slaves, and that Pharaoh was not going to give up an economic benefit to his country in this cheap and free labor that they were able to garner from these slaves. It wasn't going to be an easy sell. And yet by faith, Moses went and led his people out of Egypt. And it's story after story after story like this in the book of Hebrews in chapter 11, so much so that it says this toward the end. It says, and what shall I say? I don't have time to tell about Gideon or Barak or Samson or Jephthah, about David and Samuel and the prophets who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, and gained what was promised, who shut the mouths of lions, think Daniel, quenched the fury of the flames, escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned to strength, and who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies. And then he said, and women received back their dead, raised to life again. And we can think of especially the story of both Elijah and Elisha, who raised widow's sons from death to life. And what he's simply doing is saying, all these people, they have lived their lives by faith. And where are they? Well, he says, you are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses. Okay, most of us don't have to worry about what's going on in the stadium today, right? Because there's nothing going on there. But usually it's packed full, almost 80,000 people, right? And this is the picture that he's drawing for us, is that we're down on the playing field. All of these people who have run their race and walk by faith are in the stands. They're part of that crowd of witnesses, witnessing what's going on the field. The only difference between what happens in that stadium normally and what happens in this picture of people sitting in the stadium who have gone before us is in order that be true of the Packers stadium, you'd have to have every one of the people who are sitting there spectating being a retired NFL football player, because they ran the race, they finished the course, and now they're in their retirement watching everything else. By the way, this is one of the reasons why. When somebody asked me, do people who die in the faith before us know what's going on earth, what's going on, this is one of those places that says, well, they're witnesses. Now, the Bible doesn't give us a lot of specifics about that, but it says those who have run their race before us by faith and are in the stands, that's the picture that Paul is drawing here, is of the of the people sitting in the stands watching the games going on in the field. They're watching what you and I do as we make our journey through life. They've completed their course, they have run their race, and now they're witnesses to us. And what is it that you and I are called to do? Well, what anybody who's competing is always called to do, and the first thing is to get rid of the distractions. Let's throw away everything that that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. Well, what kind of things are those? Well, they're the kind of things that get in the way. So we saw these ladies compete in the Olympics recently, but they didn't compete in what they're wearing on this picture. These are called their warm-ups. And it doesn't matter what kind of contest you're in, almost all athletes have a set of warm-ups, and when it comes time for the competition, they get rid of the warm-ups because the warm-ups aren't good clothes for competing in. They will tangle them up, slow them down. And what the apostle reminds us is that there are things that can weigh us down. When I was learning how to be a lifeguard and to teach swimming lessons, when I was in college, one of the things they said is if you're ever overboard someplace, the first thing you do is get rid of the stuff that weighs you down. You kick off your shoes. You take off your pants. And if you know how to use them, you can turn your pants into a flotation device. There's a way to do that by tying up the legs and catching air. And you learn to do those kind of things. And you get rid of them because they're going to weigh you down. You want to use them to help you, not to hurt you. What is it that hurts us? Well, he says it's that sin. And sin, we know from the Bible, comes from three sources. The devil, who's always offering false promises, just like he did to Adam and Eve in the garden. If you do it this way, you're going to be better than if you do it God's way, seeking someone to destroy. And then we've got the world around us. We've got distractions, and a lot of times it's things that are going on around us that take our mind off of what's really, really important. And we have a tendency then to major in the minors, to worry about things that really don't matter in the big picture, and get all caught up in stuff. And so there's those distractions, those things that are around us. We were watching a little HGTV last night, and when somebody's spending $500,000 to $750,000 on their vacation home. I can't relate, you know? But that's the kind of stuff we see that entices us to think about, well, we need more, better, right? And then there's also those other people who will test us, who will invite us to step into the things that aren't good for us. So we've got the world, whether it's things or whether it's people, that invite us to step out of the race that God has called us to do things in a different way. And then there's our own sinful self, our own sinful desires. When I think about what's often referred to as the seven deadly sins, what are they? Well, here they are: lust, gluttony, greed, sloth, wrath, envy, pride. Where do all those things come from? My heart. It's my heart that lusts. It's my heart that becomes gluttonous. It's my heart that's greedy. It's my heart that's slothful. It's my heart that's wrath-filled. It's my heart that's envious. It's my heart that's prideful. It comes from inside me. And so there's the devil, the world, and my own sinful flesh. And what the writer says in Hebrews is that it takes conscious effort to discard those things, to put off those things, that sin that so easily entangles. Get rid of those and put on instead a focus that is designed and determined to keep Jesus at the center. To keep Jesus on the center so that you can rely on God's power, so that you can rely on the resources that God has given you to run your race, so that you can rely on God's ways and you can look to Him for the direction that you need in your life. All this by fixing your eyes on Jesus. And we're reminded that in this particular kind of journey, our race isn't a sprint, it's a marathon. And if, in fact, it's a marathon, it means we need to train for endurance and not for speed. And it's not something that our culture likes too much. We like instant gratification, not delayed pursuit. It's seen already in the pursuits of our first graders. There was a test that was done a little while ago between first graders in Japan and first graders in America. And the reason they were testing is because they said these first graders scored better on math tests in Japan than they do in America. And they were testing to see why in the world this was. Is it a matter of just intellectual quotient, your IQ? Is it something that's kind of there in the culture? What is it that causes that to happen? And what these researchers did is they gave to first graders a puzzle that was difficult to solve in math. And they weren't interested in whether the children could do it at all. In fact, they made it so hard that very few of them did. What they were measuring was how long would a child stay at it? How long would a child stay focused? How long would a child stay determined? How long would a child continue to work at this puzzle? And what they found was that American children, on average, lasted about 9.5 minutes. Japanese children lasted about 14 minutes, about a 40% difference in the amount of average time a child would stay focused and determined on solving a puzzle. In other words, the Japanese children tried 47% longer, almost 50% longer, and they stayed at it even though they couldn't solve it. And so what they came to is this conclusion: is one of the reasons that the children in a Japanese culture do better is simply because they try harder and longer than American children do, because of the culture in which we're raised. It not only explains the difference in standardized test scores, but the implications are there no matter where you turn. Doesn't matter whether it's athletics or mathematics, music or math, there are no shortcuts. And it's true also in our life as children of the Heavenly Father, that our race is a marathon and we need to train for that perseverance. And so he says, run with perseverance the race that's set before you. Run with perseverance, and he also says, run with joy, with joy. And here's where he lifts up the example of Jesus, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. What was that joy that was set before him? It was the people for whom he died on that cross. It was having your and my name written in his heart and in the book of life in his Father's home that led him to persevere with joy, because he knew that because of what he did, you and I are going to spend eternity with him. And as he serves with that kind of joy, he calls us to, as the LWML slogan says, to serve the Lord with gladness, with joy in our hearts, because we know that we've already won the race. We know we already have the prize. And when we keep our eyes on Jesus, we can run our race both focused and determined. And how do we do that? He says, consider him. Literally, it means to think a lot about him, to keep him on your heart and on your mind. And as I was thinking about how hard that is sometimes to do, I came across this, and it really kind of caught my attention. It says, what if we began to treat our Bibles the way we treat our cell phones? What if we carried it with us everywhere? What if we turned to get it if we forgot it? And I've done that a number of times with my cell phone, gotten halfway here and then had to go back home because I left it in the charger, you know. What if we checked it for messages, not just once, but several times throughout the day? What if we used it in a case of an emergency? What if we spent an hour or more using it each day like most people do their cell phones? Now, I have my Bible on my cell phone, so I use it in that way, to call my attention to the love and life that I have in my Jesus, to stay focused so that I can run with perseverance and joy. And he calls all of us then, in our individual families and in our family of faith, to run with perseverance and joy the race set before us. To help us think about that, I'd like you to rise and join with me in singing. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. I wrote a second verse. This is the second verse, so that you see it before we sing it. Let's run our race persevering, putting all life's distractions aside, as we focus and fix on our Savior's love, and his joy in his life will abide. But let's sing. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Let's run our race persevering, putting all life's distractions aside, as we focus and fix on our Savior's love, in his joy and his life will abide. Now may that peace which surpasses all human understanding keep your hearts and minds through faith in your Jesus to life everlasting. Amen. Let's, today, as we remember our ladies from our LWML, say the LWML pledge as we offer ourselves to our good and gracious God in these words. In fervent gratitude for the Savior's dying love and his blood-bought gift of redemption, we dedicate ourselves to him with all that we are and have, and in obedience to his call for workers in the harvest fields, we pledge him our willing service wherever and whenever he has need of us. We consecrate to our Savior our hands to work for him, our feet to go on his errands, our voice to sing his praises, our lips to proclaim his redeeming love, our silver and our gold to extend his kingdom, our will to do his will, and every power of our life to the great task of bringing the lost and the erring into eternal fellowship with him. Amen. God says that he's going to lift up his name in the sight of many nations in these words from Ezekiel. I will show my greatness and my holiness, and I'll make myself known in the sight of many nations.
And they will know that I am the Lord.
Please be seated as we gather our tithes and offerings, and as the communion table is prepared, and we're going to do something a little bit different, not sing today, okay? So the ushers are going to come up and gather. But what I want to do is to give you an update on what's been going on with our mission in Uganda. In fact, the people from, can you either flip to the 9:30 or 8 o'clock service, or the 5 o'clock last night service? I must not have put them into this one. I forgot about that. Well, what I want to do is bring you up on the work that we've been doing in Uganda. In Uganda, we're in the process of building a school that was put into our budget, the support for that, this last year, back in December of last year when we adopted our budget for this year. And there's been a group, we're working with a group called Hearts and Hope for Uganda. They're a 501c3 in our country that's related to Messiah Lutheran Church in Weldon Springs, Missouri. They're also an NGO inside the country of Uganda, and they've built about four or five schools and assisted with a couple of others. And so they're the ones who are partnering with us because they know the system and know how to work it in order to bring the first Lutheran school to southwestern Uganda. And it's going to be, of all things, an Immanuel Lutheran school. Why? Because they're building it in the region of the very first church we built in Uganda, Immanuel Lutheran Church in Ishangororo. And so we've had the privilege of building five churches in Uganda. And as we've done that, we've had opportunity to talk a lot with the people there. We've had a couple of mission trips there. And when we asked them, should we keep building churches, they said, no, don't keep building churches, but rather we really are looking to build a school. So we're partnering with Alleluia Lutheran Church, which is my niece's husband's church. He's a pastor up there in Wrightstown, just south of Green Bay. And they're also going to be going with us and supporting this work. Uganda, remember, is in East Africa. We started our work with Salama Yagri, a personal friend and co-worker of Pastor Pete Kelm when he was on vicarage in Ghana. He was a Ghanaian pastor who was sent to Uganda as a missionary. He's holding up some of the books that we helped to produce for them in the mission work they did in Uganda. We were at Grace and Barara when we took that picture. The first church was Immanuel Lutheran Church in Ishangororo, dedicated by Pastor Kelm back in 2005. And since that time, we've built, besides Immanuel Lutheran Church in Ishangororo, Holy Trinity in Abanda, Bethany Lutheran Church in Chinimagara, Good Shepherd Lutheran Church in Kemihoko, and the one we dedicated about 2 years ago was Bethlehem Lutheran in Mabogo. And we've also provided, while we didn't build this church, Grace and Mbarara, we provided the furnishings, because the church that built it couldn't afford the furnishings, so we had helped provide the furnishings, the altar and pulpit and all that kind of stuff inside. We've also helped with supporting some land or with some animals for an animal exchange program, especially for the church workers who don't get a salary for their work. And we've helped with the Abanda Babies Home, which is in Abanda and is an orphanage. So we're in this partnership now to build a new school. And the group that was just there over the last couple of weeks surveyed the land. That's what they're doing here. As they say, there's a lot of gesturing because you don't really have boundaries. So you got to say it kind of goes from here to here, okay, as they're describing it. The path to the school, you can see it's a rather primitive path, but they said they've identified a good piece of land. They met this girl on the path, and you'll find a lot of young ladies and old ladies and men carrying things on their heads. This is a very lush part of Uganda. Parts of Uganda are very barren, but this one's very lush. Lots of vegetation, banana trees, tea plantations, that kind of thing. This was an interesting picture they just sent back. It's a pork joint. I want to find out what a pork joint is. At the base of the hill where the school would be built. This is inside Immanuel Lutheran Church in Ishangororo, the first church that we built. And this is Ronald and Pastor Benson who are explaining the sponsorship program to kids. Now, what we're going to be doing is looking for about 50 sponsors in this first year to help support children who otherwise cannot attend a school. And many of them are church workers who can't afford to send their kids. So they interviewed both kids and parents and then identified which of those kids would be eligible for the sponsorship program. They identified 14 of them so far. And we're going to have Julie Stroder from Hearts and Hope here on November 6th with bios of some of the kids who can be then sponsored. A sponsorship costs $300 a year. That pays for their education, their uniform, and a lunch every single day. For $300 a year, $26 a month, I believe it is. We've had other supporters, Kathy Schlicht very lovingly gave Bob Schlicht's memorial money to the people there to build or to buy, and it's pictured in these two pictures, a sound system, a generator, because it gives them consistent electricity for their worship and other activities, and a printer copier so they can communicate better with us out of Bob's memorial. LWML right now is involved. One of their mission projects is support a women's group called Women of the Pearl in Uganda, and they're also supporting the completion of a seminary. They just finished a seminary that was sponsored by a church in Texas, Our Savior in Kinney, and they're just having their first class of seminarians. This is a church body now with 120 congregations and 20 pastors. So they have a real need for developing their leaders. It's one of the reasons they don't want to add any more churches until they've got some more leadership for their current pastors. And this is inside of roughly 10 years when they had one pastor and two congregations. So they have had phenomenal growth in that area, and that's what we're going to be supporting. How can you help? Well, first of all, learn. As we share, please pay attention to what's going on. Pray for the work that's going on there. Adopt a child as you are able. We'll have that opportunity the first week in November. And then we encourage you to give to the mission as you have opportunity, and especially to go. If you adopt a child, one of the things you can do is meet that child when you go there. And if you adopt a child, we'll be taking sponsor packets from all those who have adopted for the children that they've adopted also when we return on mission trips. So that's what's going on. That's what we're a part of, so that people in other parts of our world can also keep their focus and run their race with perseverance and joy in Jesus. So let's rise, and we'll continue with our offering prayer.
Lord Jesus, let us pray. Lord Jesus,
as we honor you with eyes that are fixed on you and worship you through these tithes and offerings, use them to reveal your greatness, holiness, and salvation in our world.
Amen. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, fix the eyes and hearts of those who are afflicted with illness and recuperation or in treatment on you. Bring healing and comfort to them, including Dick, Betty, Virgil, Katie, Fred, Bill, Christian, Dan, Carolyn, Penny, Randy, Terry, Pastor Peter. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus, fix the eyes and hearts of those who live as husbands and wives on you. We rejoice in your blessings through 33 years of marriage for Andy and Barb Smith, 25 years for Fred and Shirley Wagner, and 12 years for Tony and Maggie Uravich. Bless Kyle at Park and Maria Hawkins as they commit to walk together in marriage next Saturday, with you as the center and model of their love. With hearts fixed on you, help husbands and wives persevere with joy in loving, forgiving, and serving one another. Lord, in your mercy. Lord Jesus, fix the eyes and hearts of those who are born and born again on you as Savior and Lord, especially Connor John Simmons, as he is welcomed to your family through water and word and baptism, and Jackson Neal Zimmerman, newborn son of Maria and Jake. Turn their hearts and the hearts of their parents to you, that they may run the race set out for them with persevering and joy-filled faith. Lord, in your mercy. Lord Jesus, fix the eyes and hearts of those who guard and protect us, our communities and our nation on you, giving their perseverance and joy and service, including our police officers and firefighters, and the members of our armed forces, including Nathan and Alex, Matt, Jason, Alan, Chris, Tim, Victoria, and Matt. Lord, in your mercy. Lord Jesus, fix the eyes and hearts of those who share your word here and around the world on you. Make fruitful our work in proclaiming your love here and among the nations, along with Shaolin and Christian Trump in Kenya, the Lutheran Church in Uganda, Congo, and Kyrgyzstan, Salam and Georgina Ayargri in Ghana, and Phil and Jamie Eagle in Asia. Continue to guide and direct the Hearts and Hope administrative team as they aid us in finalizing plans for our support of the building of a Lutheran church, a Lutheran school in southwest Uganda. Lord, in your mercy. Lord Jesus, fix the eyes and hearts of the members of all our households on you. We give thanks with Danielle, Sarah, Marcus, and Samantha Kelly for all the blessings you have given us. Lead Jed, Elizabeth, James, and Grace Kirchenwitz in the development of their gifts, especially James and Grace, as they continue their educational experiences this year. Continue to bless Joe and Samantha, Bailey and Bay Kalkoff, along with Katie Kigley and Darren Keel, especially Darren's son Noah, as he grows in faith with each of us, not to not be distracted by sin, but determined to run our race with perseverance and joy, our eyes fixed on you. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread in his hands. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. He gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do as often as you eat it, in remembrance of me. In the same manner also, he took a cup filled with wine. And again, when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament, shed for you in my blood for the forgiveness of all of your sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Thank you. Blessed be with you now and forever.
Mercy.
Mercy.
body and true blood of our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve us all in true faith unto life everlasting. Depart in peace and in joy. Amen. Stand as we sing. Let us pray. Thank you, Father, for feeding me at your family table with the true body and blood of your Son. Continue to send your Holy Spirit to me, along with my sisters and brothers in my family of faith, growing my faith, undergirding my hope, and increasing my love. To Christ Jesus, my Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another.
By this everyone will know we are his disciples, if we love one another.
Rooted and established in love, may you have power, together with all the Lord's people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, to know this and share this love, that surpasses knowledge, filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Amen.
We join in singing. Oh, come on. God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
Amen.
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 And amen.
Amen.
There we go. Thank you.
Yeah.